Hello students, today I am going to start the 7th unit and the title of the unit is evaporations. So in this unit we will cover different topics starting from the boiling point elevations, then we'll talk about type of evaporators, then we'll talk about the design of single effect evaporators, design of multiple effect evaporators, vapor compression systems, vapor recompression systems actually. So in today's lecture I'll cover up to this mechanical vapor recompressions and I'll this point number 7.3 and point number 7.4 I'll cover in the next lecture because it involves some calculations. So after going through this unit you will be able to answer that what is the difference between evaporation and rest of the technique in which there is a involvement of water removal and how we perform evaporations basically and what are the different type of evaporators. So now I'm starting. So I think there is no need to define why we carry out evaporations because evaporation is something in which there is a involvement of water removal and why we remove the water just to decrease the water activity and if we decrease the water activity then we can keep the product for a longer time. So this is the ultimate aim. Other than this the evaporations also offers us that transportation and storage facility by means of reducing the waters we can transport the material easily and even we can store it easily. These are the 2-3 advantages of evaporations. So what is the definition of evaporation? First I am coming to that part. Evaporation refers to the process of heating to the boiling point to remove the water as vapor. So simply it is a process in which we heat the water to its boiling point and as it reaches to the boiling point it is evaporated. Now what is the principle of operation of evaporations? The driving force for the heat transfer is the difference in the temperature between the steam in the coil and the product in the pan. So for evaporations, we generally take a material in a pan and the pan is that is guarded by the coils in which there is a heating medium is circulating. So the temperature difference between the temperature of the heating medium and the temperature of the product which is inside the pan, that is the main driving force. The steam is produced in the large boilers, generally tube and chest heat exchangers. The steam temperature is a function of steam pressures. So in these coils we use to circulate the steam and it is been said that the temperature of the steam is a function of pressure. If we will increase the pressure then we can maintain the high temperatures. So water boils at 100 degrees centigrade at 1 atmospheric pressures, but at the other pressure the boiling point changes. As its boiling point the steam condenses in the coils and gives up its latent heat. So like its boiling point, actually what steam do when we are circulating the steam, steam will lose its latent heat and it will transfer the heat to the inner product and it will condensate. This is the principle of operations. So there is always a confusion between 2-3 terms, that is evaporation, drying, dehydration, and I think distillation is not that part, but for sure there may be a confusion that why we are using term evaporation, drying, dehydration and how this evaporation is different from distillation. So in all these three unit operations like up to dehydration there is a mechanism of the method of operation is that we use to remove the water. Then what is the difference? So difference exists here. Evaporation is generally related to or you can say only related to the liquid foods. And after heating or after removal of the moisture content, the end product we obtain also a concentrated liquid. Mean to say that the end product of the evaporation is not a solid product. So in comparison to evaporations, if we talk about drying and dehydration, our end product is solid. So if we are getting a solid, then we classify it as a drying operation or a dehydration operation. But in case of evaporation, it only deals with the liquid foods. So here you can see these are the two examples in which I have shown dehydrated or you can see dried vegetables. And here it is an example that milk has been converted into powders. So that's why we called it as a spray dried powders, not as a evaporated powders, dried powders. That's why we used to say like that. So if we talk about drying and dehydration, the main difference between the drying and dehydration is that drying is also a removal of moisture, dehydration is also a removal of moisture. In both cases, the end product will be solid. But the difference exists here. In case of drying, we used to carry out in uncontrolled condition, like solar drying we are carrying out. As in Bhutan, we used to keep the chili on the rooftop. So there is a moisture and we do not have any control. The moisture removal can be around up to 10%, 7% or 12%. But if we talk of, if we are using the terminology dehydration, so dehydration simply means the almost removal or the complete removal of the waters. And technically it is defined as when the moisture content of the product has reached to below 5%, then we used to call it as a dehydrated product. So dehydration, if we compare the drying and dehydration, the moisture removal is more in dehydration. It is carried out under in controlled conditions and it is very effective and a fast method in comparison to drying. So there is another term, distillations. In case of distillations, we use to heat the materials and there is generation of vapor. Same thing happened in case of evaporations. We used to heat the material and vapor generations. But evaporation is different from distillations because in case of distillations, we carry out further fractionation of the vapors and on the basis of that vapor fractionations, we collect the distilled outcomes or you can see this distilled material like in case of any preparation of any kind of whiskey, brandy or vodka, we generally collect the ethanols by the process of distillations. I hope this slide will help you. So this is the example of single effect evaporations or single effect evaporators. So the evaporation is a very simple technique in which we generally use a heat exchangers. Here it is a heat exchangers. These tubes are the heat exchangers. Fine. So and the material is fed into the this chamber and we used to circulate the steam, like steam is entering in this tube. So this steam will circulate in the tube and the material will flow over the tube. Okay, and here we create a partial vacuum. So due to creation of partial vacuums, we will achieve the boiling point of the water comparatively at a low temperatures and it will help us to accelerate the heating process. As a result, there will be a the product temperature will rise very fast and then it is entered into the separators. In the separators there is a mechanisms we use to collect the vapor and these vapors can be finally discarded. Vapor produced can be discarded, we are not using it. So this type of the arrangement is known as single effect evaporators. See, here we have circulated the steam and as the steam is losing the temperatures, it will condensate and the condensate will be collected from here. From the bottom part, we are supplying the liquid and this is the raw material and upon heating, it is now a mixture of, you can say it is at a high temperature and it contains vapor. In the separator, the vapor will be removed and from the bottom part of this separators, we will collect a concentrated product. So here it is a kind of condensers, we can cool it and we can discard the vapor. So when the vapor have been discarded, then we are not using the vapors or we are not reusing the vapors. That type of the evaporators is known as single effect evaporators. There is another type of arrangement in which we are using the vapors that are generated from the first evaporators or you can say the first part of the assembly. So here you can see there are the three evaporators which are connected in the series. So if you will look at this arrangement, thus diagram is as simple as it was previous one. The steam has been introduced here, okay, and our steam is at a high temperature. Upon losing heat, it will condensate and condensate will be collected from this side. From the bottom part, we are supplying the liquid, okay. So when it is coming in contact with the high temperature tubes, its temperature is increasing. As a result, the liquid present in this liquid feed, the water present in the liquid feed will get vaporized. Okay, so in the separators we are collecting the vapor, and from the bottom part of this separators we are collecting the concentrated liquid. Okay, so now what we will do, we will this concentrated liquid can be further concentrated by circulating it in the another evaporators. So this is the second effect evaporator, this is the first effect evaporator, and the outlet of the first effect evaporator is becoming a inlet for the second effect evaporators. So from here we will introduce the concentrated mass, and from the top we will introduce the vapors. Those have been, you can say, those were generated from the first effect evaporators. Now these generators, these vapors will do the same things. They will lose the heat to the product, and this product will be, you can say, further concentrated, and this vapor will be condensated here. Now again we will feed it into the a kind of separators. In the separator again we will recover a concentrated liquid, and this is the outlet of the second effect evaporator, and this outlet will be treated as inlet for the third effect evaporator. So same liquid is circulating. The outlet of the first has been introduced into the second, and the second outlet has been introduced into the third evaporators. So the vapor generated from the second has been introduced into the third one. So in this way we have increased the efficiency of the process. So this is a kind of co-current directions and a forward direction type of arrangement. Depending on our requirement, we can make a backward type of arrangements, like the steam and the product are moving in the same directions. So at the last stage we can discard the vapor, or we can use we can compress them and we can reuse it. So the final outlet of the third effect evaporator will be our desired product. Wait. So the next topic is the elevation in the boiling point. So I think you are aware about this topic, elevation in the boiling point, why the elevation happens in the boiling points. You might have studied in your lower classes. Whenever we add a solute inside the water, then there is an increase in the temperature, temperature of boiling point, I'll say. So why we are studying this elevation in boiling point under the heading of evaporations? Reason is that when we carry out evaporations, then there is a loss of moisture content. As a result, the solute concentration increases in the solution. As solute concentration increases, it decreases the rate of heat transfers. So it is very difficult to remove the further moistures from that particular solutions. And the boiling point also increases as the concentration, or so this evaporation process proceeds. So to show the impact of the solute concentrations and how the increase in solute concentrations can be responsible for elevation in boiling point, there is a particular chart that is known as Doering chart. And according to this chart, on this chart there are two axes. On x-axis boiling point of water has been plotted, and on y-axis the boiling point of solution has been plotted. So there is a linear relationship, you can see here. So this line is indicating if there is no solute, then it is starting from the zero. Okay, then the next line is for the 5% solutions, it is for the 10%, the next is for the 15, 20 and so on. So here there is a numerical problems by which you can understand it very easily. See here, use this chart to determine the initial and final boiling point of the liquid food with a composition that exert vapor pressure similar to that of sodium chloride solutions. The pressure of the evaporator is 20 kilopascal. The product is being concentrated from 5% to 25%. So here there is has been given a special condition that pressure has been given 20 kilopascals. So according to a particular table that is provided in the book, at 20 kilopascal the boiling point of water is around 333 Kelvin or 60 degree centigrade. So 333 degree will exit here only, because this is 330 and this is 340. In between there are 10 compartments. So you can say here it is concentrated from 5%. So at 5%, it will be around 333, isn't it? Corresponding here it is 333 and it is concentrated from 5 to 25. So 25 is the this line. So it is almost touching to the 340 and it has been observed that it is around 337 Kelvin. So here you can see that the temperature, the boiling point is 60 degree centigrade if the concentration is 5%, and it has increased to 64% if the concentration has increased from 5% to 25%. Now I'm going to cover the different type of the evaporators, and the first one is the batch type pan evaporator. It is a very simple evaporator. Here you can see there is a steam jacketed vessels. This is a steam jacket, and in which there is a vessel. In this vessel we use to keep the product, or we keep the solutions from where we will carry out the evaporations. Fine. So here we can create a partial vacuum so that we can increase the efficiency. There will be a removal of the moistures, and that can be separated or that can be fed into a condenser, and finally it will be discarded. Okay, so there are some in limitations of this process. Number one, the heat transfer per unit area volume is very small, so as a result the residence time is very long in this particular case, and the heat transfer is taking place due to the natural convections. I hope you understand. From this point the steam is entering here, it is losing the heat to the solutions, and from here we are getting the condensate. After reaching the final concentration, we are getting the final product here. Okay, second is the natural convection evaporators. So in case of natural convection evaporators, this is made up of very small vertical tube, length around 1 to 2 meters and having a diameter of 50 to 100 millimeters. So these tubes are 1 to 2 meter long and with a diameter of 50 to 100 millimeters. So these tubes and steam as a whole, they are termed as calendaria. This tube and the chest tube is this one. Then in the tube we are allowing the material to which we wish to evaporate is flowing inside the tube, and outside the tube there is a steam. So here you can see the steam has been introduced, and from the bottom part the liquid will start heating, and due to density difference it will start rise, and there is a provisions like here. After reaching the top it will fall down. The liquid may fall down, and it will continuously, this process will be carried out until the final concentration or the final TSS percentage has been achieved. Or there can be another way, like rather using these techniques, the product can be fed into a separators from where we can collect the product, and we can collect the vapor. Fine. So here this is the velocity of the fluid that is moving inside the tube. It is 1 meter per second. Another is the rising film evaporator. In case of rising film evaporator, again it is made up of vertical tubes, and here in this case the tube length is bit higher than the natural circulation evaporators. The tube's length is 10 to 15 meter long, and their diameter is around 2.5 to 5 centimeters. Diameter is also big, length is also big. Okay, so how we operate it? First of all, the feed has been introduced in the bottom. So here there is a steam, and due to steam the material will start, will be heated up, and it will turn into vapors. As a result, the liquid will rise in the tube in form of vapor or in form of bubble, and when it is rising in the tube it will make a thin layer of the liquid, and by the time when it will reach here it will be transferred in the separators, where it is in the separators what is going inside the separator? There is a hot fluid which is going inside the separators. So from these separators we will collect the vapor, and from the bottom part of the separator we will collect the concentrated product. Okay. So as I said, the thin liquid film move rapidly upwards as we start the process due to heating. So here in this case the convective heat transfer coefficient is very high, and there is if we find that after collecting the product here, and if we observe that product has not reached to that particular concentration, in that case we can recirculate the product. So that is a optional. So this type of arrangements can be lead to the four effect. Four effect means that if we talk about the multiple effect evaporators, so this type of arrangements can be used for the four effect evaporators. So the temperature difference required between the temperature of the steam and the temperature of the product, it is very less. It is around 14 degree centigrade. Fine. So the residence time of the material inside the tube is 3 to 4 minutes. And this is the example of rising film evaporator. Why we are saying rising film evaporator? Because the feed has been introduced from the bottom and now feed is rising in the tube. Okay. And then we are collecting it from the top. Now I'm coming to the next type of the evaporator. Before that, you will like to play this video to make you understand it very clearly. So in this video, you will see here.
Increases after being preheated.
See, this blue line is indicating we are introducing the feed inside the this rising film evaporator. This body is the rising film evaporator, and this is the separators, which is separating the product, and from here the vapors have been recirculated. They will be compressed and will be fed it again. Okay, how it works, you please go through once.
Heated by the primary heat exchanger. So then we'll be transported the to the tube bundle in the rising film evaporation system by a feed pump. Secondary steam from the side channel compressor is introduced into the heat exchanger's shell side.
So this red color is indicating
temperature
that this is
the feed liquid in the tube will increase due to heat exchanging with hot steam on the outside of the tube. Feed liquid flows upward in the tube, which initially has a full liquid flow, then transforms into the liquid gas mixture flow as evaporation occurs during the process, and finally turns into the spray flow at the top end of the tube. Liquid gas mixture flows into the separator at high speed. Non-evaporated liquid condenses to the bottom of the separator and circulated back to the heat exchanger, and steam will be generated in the process directed to the compressor to increase its temperature content to reuse at heat source.
I hope you understand that the feed has been introduced here and it start boiling, and by the time it reached to up to the top part of this instrument, it is a mixture of gas as well as the liquid which is been introduced in the separator. In the separator, this blue portion is indicating it is the concentrated product, and from the top part we have collected the vapor, and this vapor have been recirculated and recompressed and will be fed into this evaporator again. Fine. So now I'm moving to the next slide. So in this case, these are the two examples. One is the falling film evaporator and another is the combination of both falling and rising film evaporators. So in case of falling film evaporator, the arrangement is almost similar, but the length, the tube size is bit wider. In that case, it was around 2.5 to 5 cm, but here the diameter of the tube is 5 to 25 cm. The residence time is comparatively less as compared to the falling rising film evaporator. Here the product stays for 20 to 30 seconds. Okay, and we have to maintain a temperature difference, means we have to keep the steam at a high pressure. So it can be used for the 10 or more effect. 10 or more effect means we can connect 10 evaporators. So the previous one was used for the low viscosity fluid and it can also handle the more viscosity fluids. Now I'm coming how it is operated. So first of all, the feed is introduced from the top. Okay, so this, after when the feed has been introduced here, this will travel inside the tube. Okay, and outside the tube there is a provision of steam injection. So this tube will be heated up by the steam. As a result, this steam will be condensated and we will collect the condensate from here. And from the bottom part, we will collect the concentrated product. And from the by feeding it inside a separators, we will collect the product from the bottom, and from the top we can collect the vapors. This is a very simple arrangement, and this is the instrument which is used for the heat sensitive materials, especially the orange juice heating is carried out in this case. But there is a problem when we carry out operation in the falling film evaporator. Problem is that there is a problem of distribution of liquid in a uniform film flowing downward in a tube is more difficult. Mean to say that when we allow the liquid to pass through this tube, the uniform layer, achievement of uniform layer is very difficult. So to meet out this or to overcome these problems, either we use spray nozzles or we either use a kind of distributor over the top. And by using this spray nozzle or distributor, we can overcome these problems. So thin liquid film moving downward under the gravity on inside of the vertical tubes. So that film was rising due to the vapor formations, but here the liquid is moving under the effect of gravity. So this is the combination of rising film and falling film evaporators. In the one sections, here you can see these are the tube. In these tubes, the fluid is moving. On the outer side, there is a provision of circulation of steam. So it is cylindrical arrangement. Half of it is the rising film evaporator. So from here, the material is reaching to the top, and after reaching to the top, it is coming down. So in this way, we can concentrate it in a better way, and it is followed by the separators. With the help of separators, we are collecting the concentrated product, and the vacuum we are means the vapors that has been collected will be subject to the kind of further compressions, and we create vacuum here just to increase the yield of the vapor. So here is another video by which it will be more clear how this falling film evaporator works. Will you please go through? So this is the top part. As I said, either we can use a spray, or this is the distributors. Liquid is not directly falling on the tubes. It will first fill this upper basket, and then the liquid will come in a uniform way in every tube. So from this inlet, we are introducing the steam here. So the liquid inside the tube will start heating. Now you can see that it is getting a bit cloudy or kind of foggy appearance has been developed. By the time it will reach to the bottom part, it will be a mixture of your vapor as well as the concentrated product. So here you can see there will be a dumping of the concentrated product in the bottom of this falling film evaporator, as well as some of the material that is having both your vapor as well as the concentrated product will be entered in the separator. And in the separator, again the process will be same. It will be a kind of cyclone separators. So the solid material will fallen down, and the lighter part, that is the vapor, it will be, you can say, circulated further. I hope concept is clear. Only difference is that in the first case, the product was moving from top, bottom to top. And why the product was moving from bottom to top? Because we have been provided here heating. Due to heating, it has been converted into vapors, and the vapors start rising because due to the density difference. As we heat the solutions, it's become lighter. Here it is at a high pressure, and as a result, pressure difference, it is moving up. But here the condition is different. We are allowing the product to fall from the top. It is coming down under the effect of gravity, or surrounding this product is coming within the tube, and outside the tube there is a circulation of steam. That steam is transferring the heat, and by the time it reaches to the bottoms, it is a mixture of vapor as well as concentrated product. So from the bottoms we can collect, and from here also we can collect the concentrated product, and we can collect the vapor from the separators. Fine, I think. So here it is the diagrammatic representation of this that combined one rising and falling film evaporator. So you can see here the yellow line are indicating this is the product, and this blue line is indicating this is the tube. Okay, so the product is moving up. After reaching the top, it is coming down, and after reaching down, we will again fed it into the what you say this separator, and we will collect concentrated product as well as your what to say this vapors. Next type of the evaporators are the forced circulation evaporator. Before this we were talking about the natural circulation evaporator. In case of forced circulation evaporators, the arrangement is almost similar, but there is a difference here. Suppose this is the heating chamber in which we are carrying out heating, but if you will look at these things, they were immediately introduced here. You can check they were immediately fed into the like here. Now in this case you can see it was immediately fed into the separators, but in case of this one forced circulation evaporators, we used to maintain a hydrostatic head. And what is the beauty of this hydrostatic head? It is exerting a pressure. As a result, the vapor that what's going on basically, let me tell you, we are introducing the steam from here. This steam is circulating in this calendaria, and the condensate we are collecting from here. There is a pump. This is axial flow pump, which is pumping the liquid at a very high speed, at a speed of 2 to 6 meter per second. So liquid is flowing inside this zone at a very high speed, and due to as it is coming in contact with the hot surface, it can be converted into vapors. But this hydrostatic head will not allow the vapor to boil, or boiling will be stopped, or you can say the excess vapor generation will be stopped. So now in a liquid form which is entered in the this kind of separators. So here we have another provisions. Here we maintain a pressure P1, and here we maintain a pressure P2. P2 is lesser than P1. Fine. So when we expose this liquid to a low pressure, then there is a flashing of the vapors. All of the liquid which is present in this concentrated, or you can say this raw material, will be converted into whole of the water will be converted into vapors, and in this way we will collect the concentrated product. This is the concept of this forced circulation evaporators. Now I'm talking about the agitated thin film evaporator. In case of agitated thin film evaporator, see, this pump is supplying the raw material. From here you can follow me. From the top, we are introducing the feed, and this feed is the very viscous fluids. The feed is spread on the inside of the cylinder heating surface by a wiper blades. So this has been introduced here, okay? And this is the rotor assembly between one. You can see the central one, and this zone is your vaporizing section, okay? And here there is another pump. With this help of this pump, we are introducing the steam at a very high temperature and high pressures. Okay, so you can assume this is a cylinder, and if you will see the cross section area, we are dumping the liquid inside it, and then there is a movement of wiper blades. Scraper blades are there, and it is rotating. This black color assembly, or you can say this rotor assembly, is the this part is has been shown in this disc form. So it is continuously rotating inside the cylinders. So purpose of this rotation is that it is enhancing the rate of heat transfers. Okay, so very low heat transfer is possible because it is a very high viscous fluids, and by the time it reaches to the bottoms, we introduce it in the separator, and finally we collect the concentrated product. So it has been observed that this is not that efficient, and it has high capital cost, high maintenance cost, as well as low processing capacity. In place of this, in industry people are using the plate evaporators. If we talk about the forced circulation evaporators, the capital and operating cost are very low. liquid entering the separator flashes to form a vapor, as I have already described. Now I'm coming to the vapor recompression systems. So why this vapor recompression system is required? We have studied about the multiple effect evaporators. So when the before that I'd like to show where, from where the vapor are coming. See, this is the vapor that you can see, this is the product which was fed into the separator, and from this separator we have collected the concentrated mass, from the top we have collected the vapor. So this vapor is not that at high temperature. So to increase the temperature of this vapor which is coming out, we can have two provisions. Either we can do the thermal decompression or we can do the mechanical vapor recompressions. So arrangement is very simple. Here you can see, let the vapor is entered in the evaporators, okay, and it will circulate in the product is inside the tube, okay, because we have fed the raw material from here. So from here the heated material is entering into a separators. You can take it as a separators. So this is the, you can say, heated vapor. The vapor was circulating in this open space, and by losing the heat they have been condensated. From the bottom we have fed the feed material. The feed material is now has been heated up. It contains vapor now as well as the concentrated product. So from bottom part we will collect the concentrated liquid. Now this vapor is there. So this vapor is not at high temperature. So recompression is simply, we will compress it. We will apply the pressures, and it can be achieved by two ways. One is the thermal decompression. In case of thermal decompressions, we will introduce a steam that will be at high pressure and high temperatures. Fine. So as a result, it will increase the temperature and the pressure of the steam. And it can be only used if the vapor requirement or the steam requirement here is, means the steam which is required here has need to be at low pressures. So by using the high pressure steam here, we can produce a steam that is a low pressure and at a high temperatures. I hope you understand. Recompress, it involves the use of a steam jet booster to decompress part of exit vapor. Number two, steam should be available at a high pressures, and if this type of the recompression is used for the single effect evaporator. Next type is the mechanical vapor recompression. In case of mechanical vapor recompression, all arrangements are same. See, this is the your separators. From the separator vapor are leaving the systems. So rather using here, we were using a flash of high heated, or you can say high pressurized steam. Rather using the pressurized steam, we will feed it into a compressor that we have studied in the Carnot cycle, and this compressor will be driven by a electric motors. So it can be, the vapor compression is accomplished mechanically using a compressor driven by a electric motor, steam turbine or gas engine, depending on the availability. So by rotating at a high speeds, we will increase the pressure. As the pressure of this vapor will be increased, temperature will also increase, and then again and again we can use the vapor, same vapor in this particular evaporator. And these two type of the recompression systems has been used in the multiple effect evaporators. So after that, a very small portion remaining that contain this calculation part. I'll cover it in very short lectures, and please wait. By tomorrow, I'll upload it. Thank you very much.